Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Please put your phones on the silent mode or switch them off. There's a lot of space in the front. People who are at the back, they can please take the front seats if in case. It's so nice to have an old-time AMA well-wisher and a past president of All India Management Association, Mr. R. Gopalakrishnan at AMA. Most of you are aware that he's an author and a corporate advisor with a very distinguished corporate career. He was with Unilever for over three decades and almost two decades with the Tata Group at a senior level. And as I said, he has come to AMA in the past, and it's always a treat to listen to him, share his thoughts. And basically, by training, Mr. Gopalakrishnan studied physics at Kolkata, engineering at IIT Kharagpur, and attended the advanced management course at program at Harvard Business School. And he has been a professional manager from 1967. He served as chairman of Unilever Arabia and MD of Brookbond, Lipton, and vice chairman of Hindustan Liver. And then he joined the Tata Group as the executive director, and he was on the board of directors of various Tata companies for many years. He is also serves as an independent director in several Indian companies like Castrol and ExxonMobil, and also on Hemmers Holdings PLC in Sri Lanka. And he writes a lot besides books, articles. He teaches also. And so he's engaged in instructional and inspirational speaking and in all, including today's book, which is going to be released, a biography of innovation from birth to maturity. And many of you must have read some of the articles which were appearing in Business Standard on innovation. So, and innovation has been his passion. Anyway, I'll leave the innovation part to the expert, because even the Tata Group, a lot of innovation has been done, but let him talk about it. And as some of you are aware, these other books, you know, that include When the Penny Drops, Case of the Bonsai Manager, and a very popular book for the young managers, What Does the CEO Really Want from You? Before we release the book, I request TV Rao Sahib, Professor TV Rao, to welcome Gopalakrishnan Sahib with a bouquet of flowers. So we can release the book first, then we will have his address.
Mr. Radia, Mrs. Mundra, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure and honor to be back at Ahmedabad Management Association. This is my sixth book, and I think I've done all my six launches with AMA. So will you join me in applauding? This is a tribute not to my authorship, but to their persistence. And I feel very grateful. I often, people ask me, are you a businessman? If you're a business manager, why do you write books? That's a job of book writers and academics. And I've reflected a lot on that matter. And I came to the simplistic conclusion that if authors can become businessmen, then why should businessmen not become authors? And for authors, writing a book requires them to sell it. And they're good marketeers, And they should be. They get publishers to help them. Because management is a performing art. Just opposite your building, there is a great institution. Professor Rao has also been there. And you can teach a body of knowledge, but that doesn't make you a manager. Just like you can teach a person medicine, but then you would not go and allow yourself to be cut up by him until he has had some practice. You can come out of law college, but I will not hand over a legal brief to him. So you have to apprentice and learn. And when you apprentice and learn, there are lots of theories about how human beings learn, and that's not my subject. I became 50, 55, halfway through or more than halfway through my career, and I said, I've had a lot of learning. Anybody of my age group would have had lots of learning. Is it going to go with me? Chances are yes, because most businessmen have convinced themselves that they are not good writers. But I felt it was important to write and share. And young people, I think, still value the lessons of experience rather than the experience of getting lessons. And it's a very important distinction. And I said, I must write on things which have been aha moments for me, not marketing consumer products or how to distribute, because that there are lots of good professors who can do better than me. And the first experience I had was that I realized that we are all trained and rewarded to be analytical. Where is the data? In fact, now there's a whole new profession called data analytics. Thank you. I shall refer to this in a moment. But in the big decisions in life, I realized you are not following data. You're following your intuition, your gut feel. So you use data as much as you can, but you come to the end of the road where data doesn't work anymore. And therefore you use your gut feel. For example, in your personal life, whom to marry, you know, you get some information about ladki ne kya kiya hai, kahan pe hua hai, which family. But after that, you use your gut feel. When you select a CEO, you go through his CV. Yes, he should be well educated and all that stuff. But in the final selection, you have to use your gut feel. And so on and so forth. When you make a merger and acquisition, whether you should acquire that company or not, it is by intuition. After all the analysis has been done. So I wrote my first book, The Case of the Bonsai Manager, on human intuition. My second book was on self-awareness. In Western management literature, I am saying this in front of a behavioral science guru sitting here, self-awareness is an early management skill. So before I was 30, 35, I think I was been put through all these T groups and IF, TJ and all that stuff, you know, mumbo jumbo, which told me what type of a person I am, what type of a person somebody else is. But I realized that according to Vedantic literature, it is a late life skill. The higher the monkey climbs, the more of his backside you can see. So when you are a young officer, small little defects, which all of us have, we are all released from the factory without full quality control. So all of us have defects in our personality. But as you rise, those become very big. And they are seen by everybody. You're egoistic. You're a megalomaniac. You're a control freak. You want to do everything. You won't even let your own son take an initiative. You know, these things show up. So I wrote my second book called When the Penny Drops. Then my third book was about obligation and privilege. I saw many colleagues saying, young people nowadays are different. I see at least a few young faces. Of course they are different. I was different from my father. So you should be different from your father. But to say that they are selfish, inward-looking, money-minded, seem to dismiss a whole generation of people, which is not true. So I wrote a book saying that obligation and privilege are two sides of the same coin. And I did a very interesting exercise at Tata Management Training Center, where I asked people, what do you owe the company? And they didn't, with great difficulty, got to three items, four items with difficulty. Loyalty, hard work, creativity, that's it. Then I wrote on the other side, what does the company owe you? It is difficult to stop the ideas coming. Good job, good salary, promotion, foreign posting, good housing. In those days, housing was difficult. And so on and so forth. A loan, scooter loan. So I said, my God, what kind of a balance sheet is this? Where the company owes you 25 things and you owe the company only 3 things. This cannot work. In a marriage, you think you owe your wife, if I give you monthly money, you're okay. But she owes you to press your feet, to give you hot rasam and food. It doesn't work. So I wrote my third book and so on until I had another epiphany which has caused me to write this book. So I should get to this book. If you don't mind, I'll take this off. So what happened was, like everybody else, I've been interested in the subject of innovation. But a few things started striking me, that there is a lot of books on innovation. If you look at any management library, you'll find innovation and leadership filled up with lots of books and articles and so on. So I didn't have any deep emotional attachment other than it's a nice word. But I said, where did this word come from? And I realized that until 200 years ago, the word innovation had a negative image. The word everybody used was invention. And invention meant you invented a steam engine, you invented something new. Innovation came from the word novation, which means you're reinterpreting something else. What in Hindi we call jugaad. You're reinventing. So you novate a legal agreement. You novate a will. And I said innovation had a negative image. But in the last 40 years, I did an n-gram analysis. The word innovation has crossed invention. It's become a very, very powerful word. Everybody wants to have innovation. So I said, this is the word whose life has, time has arrived. I then, between my wife and me, we speak about 7-8 languages, you know, Gujarati, Marathi, Tamil, Telugu, Bengali, and so on. I said, what is an Indian word for innovation? An Indian word which is used colloquially, not some Sanskrit dictionary derived word. Now, Mrs. Mundra tells me that in Gujarati you say Navinikaran. I don't know if a grandfather will call his grandson and say, Beta, tame Navinikaran karo cho. I doubt.
Yes, absolutely.
It is. So there are not many Indian languages which have a colloquial word, but they have a Sanskritized word. And yet Indians are the greatest innovators in the world. Because the amount of innovation you do depends on the scale and the frequency of the problems that you face, not on having the word used in your language. And in India, there is no shortage of those challenges. Getting your kid into school, getting them to study hard, reaching school with all the traffic that we have, getting them to then go to college. Each one is a challenge. And when I was younger, even getting a milk card or a ration card was a challenge. It's not a challenge anymore. So Indians are amongst the most innovative because the more pressure there is, the more you have to find solutions. You may argue that they do a lot of jugaad. I don't want to go into that subject under there's a particular question. But my real epiphany, if I may say so, happened when one day in 2005, Mr. Ratan Tata called me and said, will you lead an exercise in Tata Group to make Tata Group's culture of innovation change? And he emphasized that he was not trying to have some new processes, new software, but the culture. And as you know, changing culture is challenging. All of you are running your companies. It's always a challenge to say, how do I make people understand? How do I change culture? And so I went through certain experiences. For 11 years before I retired, I was the chairman of the Tata Group Innovation Forum. So I got a very good ringside seat with my colleagues from other Tata companies. And we did a lot of experiments and ideas were floated. I got a chance to see universities. I went to Imperial College, I went to Harvard Business School, I went to Chicago to talk to people about innovation. We talked to consulting companies, McKinsey, Bain. I went to international companies like DuPont and GE to see how this word is practiced and used elsewhere. And that gave me a certain body of knowledge. I also started writing, as Mr. Radia said, in the Business Standard on the subject of innovation. And so I had all this body of knowledge. And then I said, rather than just publish all my columns, because that will be a bore, utter bore to anybody to read, can I create what I call in Tamil an avial out of it, a mixture of vegetables, a mixed vegetable curry, so that a new insight comes. And the question was, what is the new insight on a subject which is written about so much innovation? And here's the new insight. This is, as they say, the Gayatri Mantra, which I'm sharing with you. At least to me, it's a Gayatri Mantra. Some of you may think that I've heard this before, but I'm not aware that the process of innovation has been seen in a lot of management literature and management academics as a process. It starts with an idea and ends with a successful product. And they say, use words like, it's a linear process. You go from stage 1 to stage 2 to stage 3 to stage 4, right up to stage 7 or stage 8. At each stage, there are decision points when you must answer certain questions. Then you move it like a chess coin through all these phases. I call this an engineering approach to innovation. And very often you'll find managers being taught step 1, step 2, step 3, stage 1, stage 2, stage 3. I reflected on what I had learned. I said, that's not the way innovation really happens. Innovation is a bit of a circular process. It goes, it comes back, it's iterative. And it is a more like raising your baby at home. If I told you to raise your child, that age 0 to 2 is infancy, 2 to 6 is childhood, 6 to 10 is adolescence, it's not possible to practice that, because some children become adolescent at 10, some become adolescent at 12. Every parent raises his or her child, not, they have a general body of knowledge, but there's a lot of intuition, emotion, psychology, sociology in raising your kids. You do everything as a parent, you go back and forth, but it is a biological process, it is not an engineering process. And I felt innovation was more akin to raising a child and a baby than an engineering process. And yet I was struck by the fact that so much literature, I shouldn't give the impression I'm the only fellow who's thought of it, but at least for me, it was a novel and new idea. It's like a biological process. That's why this book is called A Biography of Innovations from Birth to Maturity. And I started thinking of innovation as a human being or as a live person. Every live person starts with the mating of a spermatozoa with an egg in the womb. The equivalent of the womb is the human brain. I went and talked to my neuroscientist friends and tried to decode what's going on in the brain. Believe me, we don't know. Although the brain is there, and sometimes it gives the impression we are not using it, it's perpetually in action. And if you think of a dense jungle, where there are lots of trees with branches and leaves, the leaves are not touching each other, but they are very close. You cannot even see sunlight through it. That's your brain. These are called dendrites. They're all hanging, and they don't touch each other. And the gap between two dendrites is 1/100th of the thickness of a human hair. So they're very, very dense. And what's happening is electrical charge is passing through this and coming to the tip of the branch. Then the electrical charge has nowhere to go. And I will not get into the technicalities because I'm not an expert as to where the electrical charge starts and so on. But if you are interested, you can get a layman's view of it from the book. When it comes to the end, it has nowhere to go. And do you know what happens? It actually discharges into a chemical. it becomes a cloud and it transmits as a, like a spray, you know, from here to here. And that's how it moves across. It's the equivalent of a bee taking pollen from one place to another place. And this is happening in your brain all the time, completely chaotic, completely chaotic. Now, none of us realizes this is what's happening in our brain, that we are walking pictures of brain chaos. But when you read the newspaper, you are assured that that is indeed true, that there is a lot of chaos. But suddenly what happens in your brain, it's like an orchestra where everybody's playing their own instrument. It looks like Zubin Mehta has come and there is order. Suddenly there is music. And that's when a concept is made in your brain. For the first time, the concept has come into your brain. Ki aisa bhi ho sakta hai kya? So think of what happened to Valmiki when he wrote the Ramayana, whenever he wrote it, long, long ago. Who could have thought there could be a flying object heavier than air? But it went through his head and he designed conceptually a Pushpaka Vimana. Heavier than air. He's described it with so much detail in the Ramayana. He got an idea. And then Leonardo da Vinci, many thousand years later, 2000 years later, saw birds flying. And he said, if birds can fly and they're heavier than air, why can't human beings fly? So he took birds, cut up their wings, looked at the structure of the birds, and he designed with wooden and some canvas and tried to persuade people to fly. Nobody took the risk, obviously. But he drew sketches of it, and those sketches are lying in the museum in Italy. So people got the concept of flying long ago. It's been around for a long time. But before that concept, and they articulated the concept. So you had an idea, a concept that was formed in the head, and when you articulate the idea through words or through pictures, then it becomes an idea. A concept becomes an idea. Just like a unison in the womb becomes a baby after 9 months. That's when, for the first time, sakar ho jata hai apne samne. But an idea, the world does not reward ideas. If you just produce a baby in a maternity ward, the world doesn't recognize it. Okay, aapke ghar mein bachcha hua hai, well done. You have to do lots of things to the baby before somebody comes and congratulates you for raising your son or daughter and they are doing something. And all these processes are involved until finally it has become an adult. But after becoming an adult also, it has to go into maturity and old age. So imagine this. That's why I don't use slides to explain this, because they think evocatively of it as a biological process. The parallels come to your mind very easily. And here's what I found. That there's lots of literature on getting creative. Lots of people will tell you how to generate more ideas. Six thinking hats. How to have sessions where people are brainstorming and so on and so forth. There's lots of literature on the final part of the execution. But the stuff in between, I found, was a bit thin. Except through engineering process. So I started looking at this through the metaphor of a human being. And I found that there are certain stages, which I've described, equivalent of conception, giving the idea, which is the equivalent of maternity or the baby being born, infancy, childhood, adolescence, maturity, and then coping with old age. Because ideas also get old, and they die in due course. And so having got a different framework, I started looking at examples around me. So this is not the biography of a single innovation. It's a biography of many innovations. Because it's like saying, I've seen many children being born, and here are some of the lessons I have seen. And I found some very interesting parallels. From the time a concept is there, becoming an idea, till the time it becomes mature, it could be 35 to 50 years. It's the same as a human being. From the time a baby is born in a hospital till the time it is at the peak of its faculties. So they did this with Westinghouse scientists, people selected for the Westinghouse scholarship. They did this with Nobel Prize winners. At what age did the Nobel Prize winners peak? It was always around 40, 50 years of age. Then they said, when did they get recognized? It took another 10 years. So it's very much like a human being. You may peak at 35 to 50 years of age, and then you get recognized and get your Padma Bhushan and all the stuff, whatever, a little later. Then I took specific examples. So take a ball pen. Now, many of you young people don't think of the ball pen as an innovation, but it is a huge innovation, because when I started my career, I admit that was a long time ago, you could not sign a check with a ball pen. The bank would not accept it. Some of you remember this?
Even in
my IIT exams, if I wrote with a ball pen, that answer paper was not acceptable. So all my colleagues and friends would have fountain pens, which would inevitably leak. So all our fingers had some black ink over here. I think anybody with a little gray hair on his head would have had this experience.
Yes.
So my son's generation doesn't understand why I make a fuss about the ball pen. But it's an innovation I have seen. Like a baby, he's grown up under my nose, and I think you can relate with this. But do you know that the first patent for a ball pen happened in 1888, when my grandfather was born, great-grandfather was born? So why did it take so long for the ball pen to get accepted? It has a long story, but I've shortened it and narrated it in the book. Just like a human being, it went through twists and turns. Until a Hungarian man called Laszlo Bajró perfected it. So, you know, it's like your little daughter. When she's born, she looks one way. When she's 4 years old, her teeth are crooked and she looks this way. When she's 8 years old, she's wearing glasses and she looks a different way. And then when she's 18 years old, you say, wow, that's my daughter. And when she's getting married and she's 25, you say, meri beti hai. The same thing happened to the ball pen. And the Second World War required that you get an instrument that can, because the first time aeroplanes were used in war was in the Second World War. And so the British government, RAF, required an instrument that doesn't leak. They placed an order for 200,000 ball pens. And that's when the market took off. Now today it's difficult to buy a fountain pen. In fact, nobody uses it. Those who use fountain, my grandchildren says, Tata, you're very cute, whatever that means, for using a fountain pen. But the ball pen has completely taken over. But it was and has been an innovation. Between patent means somebody's got the concept in his head. By the time it became a young product, it was almost 1888 to 1938, so 50 years. And then it has got recognition in another 10, 15 years. And the ball pen has now become fairly universal. There are many other such innovations I've covered in the book, little stories, and that's why I call it the biography. For example, sliced bread. We take sliced bread for granted, but when my father was born, there was no sliced bread in the world. That's why you bought pav roti and you pulled it apart. No, you didn't even cut it, you just pulled it apart and stuffed it into your mouth. In those days. In 1912, somebody got a patent for a sliced bread machine, saying it'll be so much easier to handle. But it took another 20 years for Otto Rovada to actually make a sliced bread machine. And he launched the sliced bread around 1928, and they held the 90th anniversary recently in the United States. You think of sliced bread as an innovation, you think of ball pen, and then what about the commode? So, you know, Swachh Bharat days, it's acceptable to talk about these things now. The flushing toilet, which we take for granted, was patented for the first time in 1778. But it took another 1848, so it almost took almost 60 years before it became commercial. After lots of experiments, as you can see. And the guy who made it really work and commercial was a guy called Thomas Crapper. He's a Welshman. And that's why we say, I'm going for a crap. He's given his name to the activity now. So we use the word crapping, but we don't know its origin. It came from the inventor, Mr. Crapper. If you read the story of the electric bulb and Thomas Alva Edison, the electric iron, the air conditioner, they all follow the same pattern. That it takes 35 to 50 years, very much like a human life cycle. It follows similar patterns. So that was one sort of insight that I got, which was very useful. The second insight I got was that whereas many innovation books talk of it as though it is technology-led, in reality, when you raise your baby, it's not technology-led. You do read the internet or Dr. Spock or whatever book you want to read. You talk to Shalini, talks to Padmini, and they exchange notes. But there's a lot of psychology. There's a lot of emotion in the act of raising a kid. And the same thing happens with an innovation. And so you can get positive emotions, you can get negative emotions. And so at different stages of the act of innovating, you need a multidisciplinary education or approach to be able to make the innovation succeed. For example, your ego can kill your own innovation. Just like the way you raise your kid can actually suppress your child rather than let him flower, though your intention is different. And I found this to be interesting. And I said, therefore, when you raise a child, at different stages of the child, you have different types of things that promote that child's development, and you avoid things that will. So when the child is very young, you give vaccination. You will not give vaccination when the kid is 12 years old. There's a time for vaccination. There's a certain time when you want the child to be thinking along multiple lines, outside, in the broad base. When they're very young, you let them express their curiosity. But there are other times when you say, beta, exam, RI, you focus and study. So there are different, ego, anger, jealousy, these are all factors that you encounter as you raise your children. And I found exactly the same things when it comes to innovation. So there has to be in the pedagogy, the teaching of innovation, a mixture of culture, humanities and sciences, along with the technology part. And I think there's a bit of that that's missing. So I'll give you an example. You may say, what's the use of all this? It sounds like a nice theoretical thing. I know I'm in the Prime Minister's hometown, so I'm not being political, or I'm not saying, I'm just expressing a point of view. So if there is a person who thinks I'm criticizing somebody, just don't throw an egg at me. You see how Aadhaar was implemented. Okay? Nandan has often spoken about it and said, I knew there will be opposition. I'll have to go back and forth. And he took his time, placed proposals, carried people with him, went back and forth, and implemented Aadhaar. I mean, it's a huge innovation. 1.1 billion people having an Aadhaar. I don't want to get into the current controversy about security, because that's not germane to the point I'm making. You cannot deny 1.1 billion people with a unique ID and iris and all that is fantastic. You look at what happened with demonetization and GST. It was not implemented. It was implemented like the, what I call the Western model. Stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, sab theek ho jayega baad mein. You produce the baby, everybody raises the baby, this will be all right. And it got into a very different kind of implementation. There are many such examples you can get. You may, of course, disagree with me on the opinion I'm expressing, and I would respectfully accept there could be a disagreement. But you see that those that are done with circularity have a better chance of success than those that are done in a linear fashion. That is the principle I'm making. Whether GSTN falls into that category or not is a separate matter. I just don't know if you observed that there's a difference between effectiveness and efficiency. All engineers, management students are taught to be efficient. They have the subject itself has its origin in efficiency. The distance between here and there can be covered in a straight line. That's efficiency. But effectiveness is different from efficiency. So if you see, put a pot of honey there and ask me to, and I want the honey. I can turn my face, look at the honey, just get off and walk in a straight line, I can get it. But if you ask a fly to get to the honey, Flies never move in a straight line. Have you noticed? They go around in circles. And the reason is the structure of the eye of the fly is it's like two huge balloons on each side, each one having one lens. There are 4,000 eyes that a fly has. 4,000. 2,000 on this side, 2,000 on that side. But no eye can move. It's fixed. So this eye can see here, it can't see anything else. This eye can see there, it can't see anything else. So if there is a honey there, this particular eye here can see it, but none of the other 3,999 eyes can see it. And so the fly has to move its whole body and go round in circles to get to the point. That's why it moves in a circle. It is effective given the anatomy of the fly, but it is not efficient. And you'll find that many things in nature around you move in circles, in spirals, to be effective, but they're not efficient. How does water flow down a mountain? Have you ever seen water flowing down in a straight line? When you brush your teeth in the morning, how does the water go down the sink? In a spiral. How does the blood flow in your veins? Don't try this experiment, but if you cut your veins, you'll find it is not moving in a straight line. It's moving in waves, like in the ocean, standing in the sea. How does your DNA look? Not a straight line. It's a spiral. So the spiral and iterations are a very common part of human life. And so I put the whole process of innovation in the biography into these 8 stages and found for each stage that there is some kinds of promoters and some things that don't promote it. For example, at the conception and the articulation stage, serendipity is very important. Mindset of creativity is very important. Associative thinking is very important. Articulation is very important. Many innovators are not able to articulate what problem they're trying to solve. And somehow they think that that's not a technology subject and it's somebody else's job. Some marketeer will do it. That's not the way the world works. Every innovator and entrepreneur has to be a salesman of his idea. And I've covered that in the book to say people who are not able to sell an idea cannot be innovators. Either they must personally be able to sell it or they must have somebody who can sell it for them. When you come into adolescence, you must be a bit more disciplined. You must act fast and you must be networking. So I've gone through the list and there are some stages when ego can get you. My idea. I have invented it. So who invented the internet? You'll find it very difficult to answer the question. The world of technology thinks that Tim Berners-Lee invented the internet. Indeed, it is true that he is the first person who wrote the HTML protocol. But when they went to Tim Berners-Lee with great and genuine modesty, he said, yeah, don't call me the inventor or the innovator of internet. I built on the layer built by A, B, C, D, and he traced it back to 1960s in the American DARPA program, Defense Applied Research Program, and said, Vincent Van Cerf did the first work, then somebody built on that, somebody built on that, and I came, I put it all together, and I created HTML. And he said, I don't want to be a celebrity. He's a happy professor, $200,000 a year he earns in MIT. He's not worth a billion, but you know, had he thought of telling the world that he's the great inventor and put an IPR on it, he'd probably count amongst the richest people in the world. And I think there's a certain amount of modesty and humility, I can't help noticing, amongst some of the great inventors of the world. So I would like to conclude, because I don't want to go on and on prattering. Maybe there's the odd question which we can talk about. But I hope I have persuaded you that there is a different angle and different take to the subject of innovation. It occurred to me, I've taken the liberty of putting it into a book. If you read the book and you enjoy it or you critique it or you don't agree with it, all are acceptable, do write to me. My email ID appears in the book. But I think the subject of innovation is so important to our society and our country that I hope it will engage the attention of the members of AMA. Thank you so much.
So once again, before I say thank you to you, sir, innovation has a very simple definition. It is simple, should be easy to follow. It makes you learn in the process, and at the end, you feel contented about it. That's exactly what your speech was today. That's exactly what we felt throughout the thing, sharing stories, experiences, everything, and I think it was so simple. And friends, just to share with all of you on a personal note, I and Divesh were in the boardroom talking to our author today, and Ajay Bhai walked in and he said, sir, presentation hai, upar lagane ke liye, and he said, nahin. Very few times it happens that we don't have a laptop here and somebody is not changing the slides throughout. So what a relief it is to see. I think it's that itself talks about when the person has breathed that whole process. Jab wo PowerPoint ki slides mein se padhna na pade, na aapko, na mujhe, na unhe, uska matlab hai that wo process unke andar behta raha hai jharne ki tarah. Aur usi mein se thodi si boonde aaj apne ko mili hai. We are very lucky to have this. So sir, thank you so much. We're looking forward to 9th book already. I request Divesh to give a small token of appreciation right there from AMA. And before you come and meet author, and I would request you to pick up a book outside. There are a couple of books written by him already outside. My personal favorite, When the Penny Drops. It's an older book than what it is today, but it's an amazing, amazing book to read.
Thank you for those comments.
Thanks, sir.
Please, sir.
Thank you for those comments, Rama.
Pleasure, sir. Thank you so much, friends.
I'm a poor salesman. I have not appointed her to be my salesman.
Sir, we are lucky and delighted to have you here. It's a pleasure. We are already looking forward to 9th book. And I and Divesh would look forward to be here, stay on stage again and do the same thing.
Thank you.
Thank you, friends. Look forward to see you again.